From the library of the New York Stock Exchange at the corner of Wall and Broad Streets in New York City, you're inside the Ice House. Our podcast from Intercontinental Exchange on markets, leadership, and vision in global business. The dream drivers that have made the NYSE an indispensable institution of global growth for over 225 years. Each week, we feature stories of those who hatch plans, create jobs, and harness the engine of capitalism. Right here, right now at the NYSE and at ICE's exchanges and clearinghouses around the world. And now welcome Inside the ICE House.
I am your host, Pete Ash, recording from East Lansing, Michigan, home of Michigan State University, and where I'll be for the next week watching my daughter's Odyssey of the Mind team compete in the World Championships. As I drove out here yesterday, I caught up with Hidden Brain's Success 2.0 podcast series, including the episode entitled Getting What You Want, all about achieving your goals in life. Now, Shankar is one of my favorite podcast hosts and an excellent interviewer, but he neglected in the episode to talk about the one important follow-up question. What happens after you realize your long sought after achievement? Our guest today, Biggby Coffee co-CEO Mike McFall, was confronted with that exact issue after spending years building the coffee franchise into one of the largest in the country. To quote him, sometime around 2015, 2016, it became clear that Bob and I weren't going to have to worry about retirement, and we're going to be able to put our kids through college. That's where we got really pensive and started to deal with the existential stuff. Like, what is this all about? By complete coincidence, I was introduced to Mike and his incredible writing about the teachings that can be garnered from his journey through that existential stuff just a few weeks before I made my trip to the Great Lakes States. That means I'm recording this episode across the street from the Biggby Coffee headquarters, and as soon as recording wraps up, my wife and I will take a stroll to the location on Lake Lansing Road. Despite there being over 300 stores across the country, I never had a cup of Biggby Coffee until this morning, as the corner of Wall and Broad is about 250 miles away from the nearest one. Whether you have a Biggby next door or not, if you're interested in running, scaling, or even exiting a business, Mike is someone you should get to know. His first book, Grind, about starting a business, has been succinctly summarized by him as, quote, the secret to being a successful entrepreneur is sell more shit tomorrow than you did today. His second book deals with what happens when you successfully stand up a business. The pages contain his blueprint to evolve a business from profitable to sustainable for you, employees, customers, and not to be hyperbolic, but the world. Our conversation with Mike McFall on Grind, Grow, and his career will be coming up after the break.
Shopify Editions is back with over 100 product updates and enhancements all in one place. Explore our latest solutions for every aspect of commerce, from starting and scaling a business
so you can sell everywhere easier,
to flexible components for enterprise needs.
Businesses can choose which technologies they need to create the customer experience they want.
And developer tooling to customize any commerce experience.
We know how important it is to offer the right mix of power, flexibility, and customization across our surfaces.
No matter what you're building, you can build for the long term with Shopify. Visit shopify.com/additions.
Our guest today, Mike McFall, is the co-CEO and co-founder of Biggby Coffee. He began his tenure with the coffee chain that had become Biggby in 1996 as a minimum wage barista and has held every position within the company. His first book, Grind, came out in 2019, and this episode will be released on the publishing date of his follow-up book, Grow, Take Your Business from Chaos to Calm from Greenleaf Publishing Group. Welcome, Mike, inside the Ice House.
Thanks, Peter. It's great to be here.
So I mentioned my wife and I are going to get, my second cup, her first cup of Biggby after this. And we're going to both walk into the store and get our respective drinks together. Now that you've entered the grow phase of your career, does your wife let you go order your own cup of coffee, or do you still have to sit in the car?
No, I've calmed down a little in the last decade or so. And so, you know, that story goes that, you know, we used to go on trips, road trips, and I'd stop in stores and, you know, I'd walk in and I'd find 150 things wrong in the store, and it would make me super uptight. And so she, you're referencing that story where she'd make me stay in the car and she'd go in and get the coffee on a road trip.
I ended my road trip with a Biggby cup of coffee, and it was I did not have 150 issues with anything. Your new book, Grow, is dedicated to your parents. Your dad, Jim, was the entrepreneur. You wrote in Grind, your first book, that most people are entrepreneurial, but few possess the appetite for risk to set out their own. How did his experience and watching him with his journey give you the confidence to set out to grow Biggby and what you've done so far?
Well, I watched him. I was in high school when he started his business, and I watched him do what it took and that it wasn't, you know, the mentality was it's not going to fail. And so, you know, he was in there. He actually designed the machine that gave him a competitive advantage in the manufacturing space and automotive. I watched him work on that machine, tweak that machine, make that machine, you know, productive. And then, you know, there were always the nights where, you know, I'd wake up at 3 a.m. and I'd see the lights on downstairs and he'd be down in the dining room working. And, you know, it was this commitment to it's not going to fail. And he, you know, that was his mentality. I know that was his mentality. And I brought that into my world too. We're going to do it. We're going to make the decision. We're going to launch and we're going to do whatever it takes to make it work.
And if your dad inspired sort of that entrepreneurial side, your mom, Joanne, a Michigan State University professor, she must have given you the tools to not just be successful, but now doing what you're doing with your books, teaching others. And how did she inspire you? And was that emphasis on not just learning, but teaching part of the household growing up?
Well, her mantra growing up was that the only measure of success for anybody was how much they were willing to contribute to improving the human condition. And so that was her mantra. And you know, it's been my belief my whole life and probably somewhat, you know, from my dad too, was that you can do that through business. And so that's kind of the mentality I brought in. It took a while for that to evolve and crystallize for me. But at the end of the day, you know, I do believe that business, private enterprise, is the most powerful force on the planet by about a factor of 10. And so we as successful entrepreneurs, you know, we have an obligation. We have an obligation to improve the human condition once we have gotten our businesses to the point of sustainability.
And we'll talk about once you get to the business of point of sustainability, but let's go back to the beginning for our audience. Biggby has its roots very close to where I'm sitting right now. You know, you were going for a walk with Bob Fish, you become your co-founder. How did that conversation that I believe started about just, you know, maybe seeing you get a single promotion from barista to maybe assistant manager end up with this 25-year partnership?
I have the title co-founder, but I didn't build the first store. My business partner, Bob Fish, and his wife at the time, Mary Roselle, started the first store. And I applied. I walked in and applied to become a barista. And so, you know, and I loved that job. But I was at the university on a very specific research project with a colleague of my mother's, just preparing to go back to graduate school. And the coffee gig was kind of a, you know, just make a little extra cash. And so, you know, but what happened to me was a couple of things. One, I began to sense an opportunity in coffee. But two, I love going to work. I mean, I love going to work. And a lot of that had to do with this sort of hospitality mentality where you love taking care of people. And so I really thrived in that environment. And so what happened was Bob approached me about taking on a managerial role within the business. And it was this beautiful spring day and we sat down interview style at a table. And immediately popped up and ended up going for a walk. And so we ended up 4.5 hours walking around East Lansing. And, you know, the thing was, is we didn't know each other. I worked the open shift. He worked the closed shift at the store at that time. So we didn't know each other. At the end of that walk, we shook hands and agreed to set up a new company. It would be the company that we would use to develop the brand Biggby Coffee. And so the company was formed on a handshake. What happened in that walk? I don't know that I can really say. I would love to have a recording of what we talked about over those 4.5 hours, but it was life. We were pretty similar people. We had this grand sense of adventure. We had both lived relatively unusual upbringings. And, you know, but we also both had unbridled ambition. And I think that might have been the thing that really kind of brought us together. And we just talked about what could be possible. And I guess in a way dreamt about what could be possible. And so at the end of that walk, we shook hands and I resigned the next day at the university and I took over the assistant manager's job of store one in preparation to become the general manager of store two, which was being built at the time.
What about you and Bob make it such a great partnership? I know you wrote in Grind that he's sort of an introvert who can cape up and be an extrovert when he needs. You know, it's very clear from the couple interactions we had, you're very extroverted. I mean, is it simply an introvert and extrovert partnering up or what else about the two of you make it such a great team?
Well, I'll tell you a pretty eerie story that occurred. You know, the Dale Carnegie program and one of their tools, one of their exercises is you get like 40 cards. All of them have personality traits on them. And they take you through this fairly quick process of boiling those 40 cards down to 2 cards. You know, you go for 3 minutes and you take it from 40 down to 15, down to 10, down to 5, down to 2. And it's just this process. We're in this room. There's 15 people in the room. He's sitting across the table from me. I can't, you know, he's 10 feet away from me. Going around the room, we're reading our cards. It comes to Bob. He reads his 2. They're exactly mine. It was loyalty and legacy. And so we're both extraordinarily loyal, like loyal as dogs. and then we both want to leave an impactful legacy. And so we match up really well. But then also from a behavioral standpoint, he does things, and this is how we talk about it. One, he's very, very good at taking something relatively simple and making it amazingly complex by looking at it from every angle and thinking deeply about whatever that is and coming up with every possibility, every eventuality. I'm good at taking the complex and making it really simple. And so the two of us work incredibly well together. He makes me slow down. He makes me think. He makes me go through analysis and so on. But then at the same time, I bring sort of a sense of urgency to engage and execute. And so it's been magical. I mean, you know, on top of that, he's just a really good person, you know, and I think that that's, you know, I guess we just kind of got lucky in that way. I mean, he's just a really good person. And so, you know, it's been magical. It's been 26 years together. And you know, the amazing thing is I was honored last week with a Lifetime Achievement Award in entrepreneurship. And I was like, wait, I'm just getting started. What do you mean lifetime achievement? You know, but we both have that mentality. We always feel like we're just getting started right now. We're at 350 stores. We just eclipsed that number. And it's like, okay, now we've got a solid foundation. Now we can build something, you know, super powerful.
We've been talking actually on this podcast a lot about packaging. And in the book, you use a corollary of physical space as a message. So when you walk into a Biggby, whether here in East Lansing or anywhere of the other 350 locations, what do you want the customers and employees to get from that physical space of walking into that store?
We want it to be open and inviting. You know, we want people to feel comfortable. What we've done with our brand, and by the way, that's a really great question that we've spent a lot of time on over the years. And the idea is that our brand, where we want our brand is, we, you know, in the coffee space, you have, you know, the Starbucks, the Intelligentsias, the Blue Bottles on one end of the spectrum. I would say fairly pretentious brands, great brands, but fairly pretentious. And then at the other end of the spectrum, you have the McDonald's, Dunkin' Donuts, and so on. What we're trying to do with our brand and our physical space and how we name things, so internal brands, drink names, and so on and so forth, is we're trying to split the middle on those two polar opposites. And so that we can pull from either side of that spectrum. So we can pull from somebody that's going into Dunkin' Donuts or McDonald's every day and getting their coffee, or somebody that's going to Blue Bottle or Starbucks. And so that's what we try to do that with our physical space as well. We want it to be upbeat, energetic. We want people to feel comfortable, a place that, you know, isn't intimidating in any way. I remember early on in my career here in coffee, here's my mom, incredibly accomplished, very, very smart, brilliant woman. And she told me one time she walked into a coffee shop in East Lansing and she felt intimidated because, you know, she didn't know how to say cappuccino properly, or she didn't know what a latte was. And so, wow, here you have somebody who wants to spend money in your place. They walk in and you make them feel intimidated. Like, that's crazy. And there is that arrogance. You know, it's not as much anymore because so many people now know the product and so on. But back in the day, people didn't. And so we never wanted that moment for a customer. We always wanted the customer to, you know, feel invited to come in, comfortable being there, and so on.
Along that process, you're writing, you talk a lot about the collaborative process that you use at Biggby. You know, how do you incorporate feedback from customers and your fellow leaders and employees into your decision-making process without losing kind of the vision you and Bob have for the overall company?
Well, when you work hard to get everybody to understand the vision, it is, it becomes theirs too. And so, you know, that is what we try to do, right? Is we try to get everybody, and you know, when we created our vision for the organization, there was a lot of people involved in that. That wasn't just Bob and I sitting down at the table and scratching it out. It, you know, and so it's been the whole process, our purpose, our vision has been collaborative. And then, so then when you bring the people that were involved in all that into any kind of a decision-making process, they should be well aligned in theory, right? That's the idea. And so, you know, that's been, I make that sound like that's like that's always been that way, right? I mean, the transition he and I have gone through from autocratic, maniacal, obsessive entrepreneurs to where we are today has been a long journey. And that is essentially the topic of my second book, Grow.
Yeah, I read an article, I think from 2017 in the Detroit Free Press that said you were drinking 14 espressos a day. It sounds a little bit more of that, the chaos period, but I'm across you from your headquarters. You know, you have 350 locations. How do you use that space to bring sort of a unified message? Are you having your franchisees come in to use the test kitchen there? Are you going out to the field? How do you maintain that connectivity as, you know, I think you have stores as far as Virginia now from your headquarters.
Well, I mean, this might be too granular, and just stop me if it is. What we've created is a model built off of the Subway sandwich shop chain. And what they had is they had development agents around the country. So what happened was we had a longstanding relationship with Fred DeLuca, 10 years, where we were negotiating his purchase of 50% of our company. In that process, we got to know a woman named Lisa Oak very, very well. She ran his private equity fund of sorts, a family office, and they made investments in franchise companies and other stuff too. But she ran that franchising piece. At the end of the day, we didn't get a deal done with Fred. We had a purchase agreement to the letter agreed upon, and we were waiting to sign it, and he passed away. And so we never got that deal done. Fast forward, we hired Lisa Oak, who left the company when he passed. We hired Lisa Oak to become a consultant for us to develop and build the structure that Subway had, this DA structure. And we said to her, we want to build that exact model. So she came in and she built that. And so what that is, and then amazingly, it was an incredible moment when we hired her to come in and be our chief development officer. You know, when you hire one of your top five mentors on the planet, it's kind of a strange feeling, but she's been great. She's amazing. But she came in, and what that structure is you have successful franchise owners in remote geographies. And actually, they're not even remote geographies anymore. They're pretty much everywhere, where they have a geography that they are responsible for developing. And then, so they work with prospective franchisees. They help open the stores. They find the real estate. They coach and mentor the franchise owners after they're open. So that and then there's a royalty split. They get one third of the royalty. We get two thirds of the royalty. And so that was developed because we felt like we were losing the connectivity to the franchise owner in the store. And so what we wanted is an experienced, well-heeled person, leader in each geography there representing us, aligned with us from a core values and purpose and vision perspective, coaching the local operator, the local owner operator. And so that was kind of a long answer to that question, but that was a huge transition for us because we knew we were losing that connectivity. We were losing it. And so by having the we call it area representatives, the AR in place, allowed us to support that franchise owner better, and then develop the relationship with the ARs, and then therefore the franchise owners.
As you were writing that book, as you're thinking about the model, as we're kind of going back into the history of Biggby, you know, was there anything that you would change from grind of the advice you gave to entrepreneurs that, you know, may have come out of a good place in terms of where your head was in sort of this hectic, maniacal grow phase, but now that you're looking back on it, you'd want to maybe edit those pages?
No, I haven't. You know, and it's a great question. I just got done recording Grind in audio format. And so I just read it in detail, like every paragraph six times, because I'm terrible at this. And so, no, I read that book again. You know, there's a few things that are I would change how I wrote them. But the fundamental premises, I still strongly believe in. And here's why I wanted to write this book series the way I wrote it, is that you're a very different person in the startup phase, and you have to be. And then you transition into, you know, the bootstrapping entrepreneurial phase, but then you've got to transition into a leader of an organization. And then ultimately, at the end, the second half, the growth phase, is transitioning from that primary leader in the organization through to what I call irrelevance, where the entrepreneur can get run over by a bus and the organization will continue to thrive. So I've always really struggled when I give talks to entrepreneurs and so on, because my mentality today is very, very different than what it was in startup. And could I take my mentality today and go back into startup and do it again? I don't know. You know, I mean, and we talk about this all the time internally, like, does it take that maniacal, obsessive, autocratic person in an organization at startup to turn it into something that it eventually becomes successful? I think so. I mean, in many ways, I believe that. I think, you know, you have to dial the knobs around being autocratic and maniacal and so on. Like, you can't be unhealthy. But it's that obsessiveness that, you know, I don't have today. I don't have that obsessive approach to my world, to my work anymore, right? I did then. And I actually think it was probably necessary then.
You know, in our 350 so episodes of this podcast, something we've often come across is that there's companies that have the founder CEO through IPO is the way to go. And then there's just as many companies that the founder CEO needs to step back because they can't lead a publicly traded company or a scaled company. With Grind, you kind of captured that essence of you, and then in Grow is the current you. When you sent it to me, I couldn't help but notice that Grind is about half the size of Grow. So, you know, tell me about the process that you've written Grind, you know, you've been doing lectures, you're doing lots of talks about it, podcasts, you know, but when did you realize, wait a minute, I have not only something else to say, but I have a lot more to say about this topic. And how did you get set about to go write Grow and begin, which I believe now will be the second of what is at least three books that will be coming out?
It started as one book. And I realized early that book was going to be way too much. And so at my first glance, I broke it into four books. And Grind was the first one. Grow, at the beginning of the project, I designed it where it was going to be two different books, one on being a good manager and then one on being a good leader. And, you know, frankly, I just got impatient and I was like, I can't wait to write two more books. And then, because ultimately the third book in the series after Grow is the book I've always wanted to write. But I really felt like I needed to write the first two to build a foundation so that maybe people will pay attention to my message in the third book. The message in the third book is a call to action. And so I hope I'm building my chops in the world where when I go to write that third book, when people read it, I hope I can begin to have an interesting and powerful conversation in the world about the responsibility of successful entrepreneurs.
Yeah, and we'll talk about that, the second book, and then we'll get into sort of your vision for the third book in the second half. But as we head into the break, you've spoken often about your goal to one day own the Detroit Red Wings. Fellow Michigander and past podcast guest Matt Ishbia recently became the owner of the Phoenix Suns. You write about Matt in the book. What did he teach you about creating a workplace culture? And would you ever consider taking a page out of his book and buying a team across the country if that was the only option for you?
I don't know. I've thought about that. You know, let me have that problem, right? Let me have that struggle someday. But you know, Matt's incredible. You know, when you meet Matt, you know Matt. Matt's a real powerful force. And I was very fortunate to sit in a group where he spoke about his culture. And I loved it. You know, I loved it. And he's got a lot to teach. I wish he did more of that kind of thing. I really do, because he's a great leader. And it, you know, what he's built just obviously is proof of that. So, but would I ever buy it? No, I don't know. I mean, for me, I'm just a loyalist, you know. I'm getting pretty deep into hockey these days, supporting youth hockey, and I have a tier one franchise that I'm sponsoring here in Michigan, and we're getting pretty deep into hockey. So, you know, at the end of the day, it probably is more about the sport than it is that one particular team. But boy, it would be hard for me to own another team and have them show up to play the Red Wings.
You mentioned owning a team. Do you still play? Are you still going out there?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. My team's been together. In my second year at Biggby, I joined the team. So that's 25 years ago. And we still skate together. Both my brothers play in the team. These guys are my best friends. I still play. So I play twice a week now.
You also read a lot about, not to make this all about your athletic accomplishments as well, but your golf game, is it still -1 par? Are you getting out there with some, no. You know, a lot of hockey players retire and become pretty good golfers.
Yeah, no, I'm terrible now. No, I mean, you know, when I talk about my athletics, I was just good enough in the two sports that I played, hockey and golf, to realize I wasn't very good. You know, when you see the people that can make a living at it, or, you know, you get close to the people that are playing at the highest levels, like it is incredible how good they are.
It's funny you say that, because actually you talk about the book, kind of conversation you had with your own daughter. How do you both balance being supportive and encouraging, but also honest when giving feedback, whether it's a manager, an aspiring manager, or your own kin?
To me, it's about authenticity. And, you know, the culture of amazing is something I talk a lot about, where everything's amazing. The problem is when everything's amazing, I mean, you know, like, let's take, for example, you're going to give seven talks in a row and over a month, and people come up to you, the same people come up to you after everyone, tell you, you hit it out of the park. It was amazing. You know, that interview you did, Peter, was amazing. And they tell you that every time. Well, you know, you're not amazing every time. And so what you want is the real feedback. And then when somebody does tell you it was amazing, you believe it. And so that's the baseline in terms of engagement. And, you know, there's a difference between being supportive and nurturing than there is with the, like, when you're giving feedback, that may be different than being supportive and nurturing. My daughter knows I love her. She knows I support her. She knows I'm nurturing. Well, that's a baseline. But then there's feedback. And so all the feedback can't be positive and, you know, encouraging. So sometimes the feedback has to be, you're not that good. Like, you're not good enough for this family to spend 7 out of 13 weeks on the road for you to travel and play volleyball. Like, you haven't made the commitment to the sport yet. And so, you know, the end result of that was amazing, because she did, after that, she did commit. She did become a much better volleyball player. And she plays at a high school here in Ann Arbor that's a really competitive, it's got a really competitive volleyball program. So, you know, that was an amazing conversation with her. And I think she appreciates it. I'm not sure exactly, but I think she does.
I have a feeling, you know, if she's like most teenagers, she'll appreciate it later on. Right now, maybe can take it all in.
I hope so.
After the break, Mike McFall, co-CEO of Biggby Coffee and author of Grow, Take Your Business from Chaos to Calm, and I will discuss his new book, which captures the skills you need to transition from startup entrepreneur to business leader of a growing sustainable company. That's coming up right after this break.
Connecting to opportunity is just part of the hustle.
Opportunity is using data to create a competitive advantage.
It's raising capital to help companies change the world.
It's making complicated financial concepts seem simple.
Opportunity is making the dream of home ownership a reality.
Writing new rules and redefining the game.
And driving the world forward to a greener energy future.
Opportunity is setting a goal.
And charting a course to get there.
Sometimes the only thing standing between you and opportunity is someone who can make the connection.
At ICE, we connect people to opportunity.
Welcome back. Before the break, I was talking to Mike McFall, author of Grow, Take Your Business from Chaos to Calm, about his career and building Biggby Coffee. Laura wrote the introduction to Grow. I assume that's Laura Ike based on the context clues from the intro. And she talked about your evolution from a stone. You talked a lot in the first half about being a foundation to a tree. At the New York Stock Exchange, we also use trees a lot. We are found underneath a buttonwood tree. And we use that to reflect our ever-growing community, but also our commitment to sustainability. Can you talk about some Biggby sustainability efforts?
Right now, it's probably the area of the business that we have the most work to do. And, you know, it's something that, you know, we're kind of blaming and we're kind of making the excuse that we're a franchise company, that we have a lot of, local owner operators that all have varying opinions and so on environmental sustainability and also how we should go about it. Well, that's an excuse for a lack of leadership in that space. And I know we are lacking in that space. We've tried to do some things that we Bob and I put money behind a movie called Beyond Zero, which is a movie about interface carpets, which has been a real huge success. And it really tells a story about, getting better at managing your environmental impact. But, you know, I wish I had a better and more powerful answer. We have a group that's working on it. I feel like we're taking these incremental steps and that we're not being powerful enough. And I feel like we need to make a real commitment to dramatic change there. And we'll see. I mean, we talk about it a lot and we know we have to work on it, but I would say it's probably the area of the business we need to spend the most time on.
Grein talked about having an exit strategy from the start, where Grow talks more about the decades you have left in the company. You know, 25 years is not a lifetime achievement awards, as we were saying in the first half. How has your understanding and the use of the phrase due diligence evolved between the two books? And how do you view that as sort of a personal growth methodology?
I think if there's one original concept that's a theme in both books, it is this concept of due diligence, and that people do enormous amounts of due diligence in relation to or before starting a venture. And they analyze the market, they analyze competition, they analyze, you know, there's a million things that people study in relation to business, but they leave out, in my opinion, the most important variable, which is doing due diligence on yourself as the entrepreneur. You are the most important ingredient to the success of your future enterprise. Do you understand how you are going to impact that business? What your strengths are, what your weaknesses are, what strengths you can leverage, what weaknesses you need to supplement. To me, it isn't about determining whether you should or shouldn't. What it is about determining is how your behavior as a leader is going to impact the future success of that business. And then making sure that you counterbalance that. And same as a leader, same concept as a leader. And so, you know, I've always thought that, you know, there's a VC firm here in town, very, very successful. They leverage the university, you know, here in Ann Arbor. And the gentleman that runs it talks about how when he gets involved with companies, you know, it's for him, it's more about the behavior and execution of the person, the leader. And he talks about how he tells a funny story about how he'll back one company, they'll go through, they'll exit. That same leader will come back, you know, some number of years later with a concept and he knows them better now. He's more enthusiastic. He'll back that leader again. And then, you know, they'll exit. And he said, before that person sits down in the chair with their third idea, I've got my checkbook out. I'm ready to go. Right. He goes, I don't even know what they're talking about. I don't even care. I believe in that leader. They've done it twice. They've been successful. They've built teams. They've been able to exit. And it's like, so it's not about the idea. And whenever I have the opportunity to talk in front of entrepreneurs, I talk about the myth of the million-dollar idea. Everybody thinks, so many people think that the idea is what's important. Execution is what's critical. And you as the leader of the enterprise are critical to that execution.
And that stuff is something you cover in your books, is the due diligence on yourself. And you offer readers a very honest look at yourself. For example, on page 99 of Grow, you paint a honestly bleak picture of a very toxic work environment masquerading as a playground. When did you realize that there was a disconnect between the office decor and the workplace expectations? And how do you help other leaders realize that a keg in the break room isn't going to really solve real issues.
How it went down was you mentioned that really powerful moment in 2015, 16, when Bob and I were losing inspiration in the business. You know, we had a successful business on our hands, no doubt. But we were lacking, you know, we didn't want to show up as much anymore. We didn't want to be engaged. And so we realized we didn't know why we wanted to grow the business. And so, long story short, we call it the shaman in the woods story. I went on a camping trip and I met a gentleman in the middle of nowhere who was a consultant in the stakeholder capitalism space. I presented my card. He came and talked to us. We went through, we did a stakeholder assessment survey. So he evaluated all six stakeholders in stakeholder capitalism. We were doing reasonably well in five. We were failing miserably in one. The one that we were failing in was our own employees. And so then with that, he came and said, I want to do a study. I want to dive into that stakeholder. And so we did. And he did an in-depth survey study of our employees. I got that report on a Thursday night. I didn't open it. I waited till Friday morning. I opened it. I read it. And at the end of the day, or at the end of reading it, maybe an hour later, I had tears coming down my face. And I couldn't believe that I was the kind of person that was managing a business where the people that worked in that business were talking about it the way they were. It was awful. And at that point was the turning point for us. Our consultant, Nathan, told us he thought we should get up in front of the group and read the results of the survey word for word. And then make a commitment to change, make a commitment to improve. And that's what we did. And we've been on an amazing, powerful journey since that moment. It's nowhere near complete, but I'll tell you what, I love managing the business today. I love being involved in the business today. I love the people of the business today. It's just a totally different reason for being. You know, we found our purpose. We agreed upon our vision, and that's what we're up to. That's what we're doing.
How does that physically manifest? I mean, a lot of, particularly coming out of COVID, a lot of conversations about what does a workspace look like, remote, in office. What are you considering and what should other CEOs consider about sort of the physical office space before enacting policies?
I don't necessarily think that one approach is different or is better than another. And I think remote or in-person can all work. The key, and basically the premise of my second book, is you have to build an environment that's supportive and nurturing and loving for your people. Some people think that's harder to do in a remote environment. We'll see. We're trying really hard. But the concept is that in order to build a high-performing team, which is what we all want to do, because high-performing teams will get amazing results. And so to build a high-performing team, it starts with safety. The team members have to feel safe. They have to feel nurtured. They have to feel supported. Now, whether you do that in person or you do that through the remote technology, that's what we have to be striving for. And that is, in essence, the primary premises of Grow.
You mentioned that you feel like due diligence might be one of the big novel things you come from the book. For me, what was really stuck with me is this idea that the opposite of integrity is not dishonesty, but fear. Can you talk a little bit more about that and how kind of a fear can affect a company from top to bottom?
Well, I mean, fear has been the baseline in leadership and management for a long time. I believe that great leaders throughout history built environments where there wasn't fear. And that's how they had amazing results. That's how they had performance. And so, integrity, in order for somebody to feel safe, you have to have integrity, both as an organization and as a leader. And that's, if anybody in the organization sees you acting outside of integrity in relation to the core values and the purpose of the company, they don't trust you anymore. And without trust is fear. And fear is corrosive. anxiety is fear and anxiety get in the way of people performing at a high level because they don't feel safe in taking risks. They don't feel safe in challenging you. When you're a leader, it is absolutely critical that your people feel comfortable challenging you and telling you you're wrong. And to me, that is the integrity in building that environment where people feel safe is absolutely the core component to building high-performing teams.
One of the ways you've recently used to perform well at Biggby is this entrepreneurial operating system. And you talk about it in the book as one of the list of modern inventions up there with some of the more, I'd say, mainstream ones. Can you talk about what it is, its implementation, and also how that really captured the need to trust experts if you're ever going to transition from a grind to grow mentality?
Yeah, we got introduced to EOS. We hired John Gilkey as our president, and he came out of a vendor. So he owned a company that was a vendor of ours in the technology space. He sold that, and I worked him for like 2.5 years after he sold it to come in and help us run the business. And he brought EOS with him. He introduced us to EOS. And so, you know, I've got a huge debt of gratitude to him for that. EOS is the entrepreneurial operating system, and it gives you a methodology, an operating system for the process of going from today to your strategy. And it works the organization through a quarter by quarter basis of achieving your 1 year, your 3 year. And then it also does an amazing job of communicating. Right. That's probably the most powerful piece of it is that you have this broad based communication within the whole organization. So everybody knows what the organization's up to. And then on top of that, everybody knows what everybody else is up to support where the organization is going. It's magical. And so it was a guy here in Detroit, wrote EOS. He actually wrote it in Biggby, which is, you know, amazing. He has since sold it. He sold it to private equity. It's very powerful here. I would say, you know, I don't know exactly the scope, but I know Minnesota is probably the most powerful state with EOS at the moment. Michigan is huge. It's very common in Michigan to, you know, talk to somebody and say, are you an EOS company? And they're like, oh yeah, isn't it great? You know, but we also brought in, to answer the second part of your question there, we also brought in people who were an implementer, someone that was a consultant, where they walked us through executing these tools in this process, I think for 2 straight years. And then we branched off and started doing it on our own. And so it's been remarkable. And it really has changed. Like for years, we didn't use third parties. I mean, we just didn't do it. And one, we felt like everybody was too expensive. And two, we always felt like we could do it better than the third party. The problem is those two things are in conflict. It's too expensive because the pros are expensive. And you don't want to spend the money on the people that actually know how to do it the right way because they're too expensive, right? We were able to get through that mentality, you know, and a lot of that had to do with the fact that we had money to spend on outside consultants and parties to work with and so on. But so EOS, working with outside consultants was one of the things that cracked the code for us in terms of working with third parties because it was incredible.
I was going to do a little sidebar. You've mentioned a couple of times that some of the VCs in this area, my colleague John Tuttle would be offended if it didn't hammer home this point. You know, what is it about this state and this area that is nurturing these businesses and kind of a little bit under the radar to what we're seeing, you know, with Silicon Valley and New York and Atlanta and places like that? And how does it stack up?
Well, Michigan's an interesting place. I mean, Michigan was the core of one of the largest industries in America ever, right? I mean, the automotive industry. And so I grew up in a space where almost everybody was an entrepreneur in the automotive space. I shouldn't say almost everybody. A lot of my friends, parents and so on were entrepreneurs in the automotive industry. And so that industry did spur an enormous amount of entrepreneurs, built an incredible amount of wealth, and so on. And, you know, and so, and then we have got, you know, we've got two major research institutions here in Michigan, which I think that, you know, the VC firms just feed off of these ideas, the commodity, the engineering schools and so on. But, you know, Michigan is a, but it's also just an incredibly beautiful place. You know, I wish you could take some time to go over to the lake and get up north. I can't imagine you will, but, you know, it really is truly a spectacularly beautiful place.
Well, I definitely plan on spending some time exploring it this week. And this, particularly Detroit's gone through this sort of metamorphosis over the last couple of decades as that sort of core industry has changed. You talk about the future of a successful business as a super organism of innovation, the hot topic right now, AI. What role do you see AI playing in the process of creating this sort of super organism and innovation? And is that a technology that you're thinking about using at Biggby?
Yes. I teach here at the university, and a student of mine is deep into blockchain and decentralized autonomous organizations and this whole sort of new genre of how shit's going to work, right? Like, and so it is so powerful. It is so incredibly powerful. You know, for me, understanding the true basis behind blockchain technology and the power of decentralized autonomous organizations and AI and, right? I think the key is I look at it as an opportunity. I look at it as this is going to be amazing and powerful. And here's my take. Yeah, you can be scared of it. And you know what? Who knows where it's all going to go? But if you're scared of it, you certainly won't take advantage of the opportunities it's going to bring to you. And so as leaders, I'm just trying to keep up as best I can, you know, and really try to stay on top of these new technological mechanisms that offer us real opportunities. And so, you know, do I know how AI is going to impact our business and how we're going to use that to take care of the customer better and, you know, how we're going to become a more innovative company because of it? I can't tell you right now. We have people in the organization that are working on that and are skilled. Like John Gilkey, like I told you, he managed a technology business for 22 years. He's really well versed in this stuff. I remember the first time I'd never even heard of ChatGPT, and he pulled up on his screen. You know, we were on a Zoom call. And he pulled up on his screen and he starts working on this thing. This is before I'd ever even heard of it. So it was a while ago, and it was like, oh, you know, like this is magic. And so I just think that leaders, especially, you know, leaders like me, you know, 50 plus, like we got to keep looking at these things as real opportunities.
Definitely. And also, as you mentioned, you know, not being afraid of engaging so you can help shape them. You know, and one of the parts that you write about is this idea of swarming creativity, which, you know, whether you're talking about, you know, the inputs into AI or running a business requires a diversity of thought. Can you talk about some of the ways that you're using a justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion approach at Biggby to bring new perspectives into decision making, whether about AI or just how to run the shop day to day?
Yeah, well, the biggest one is two fat, rich, white dudes aren't running the minute, day by day anymore. And people need to acknowledge that it does. If you've got, you know, two 50, 60-year-old white dudes running the organization, calling all the shots, that is an extreme, that both came from privileged backgrounds. That right there, the bias there is extraordinary. And so we need to acknowledge that. I was up for a trustee position, and I kind of thought I was a no-brainer for it, you know, and I didn't get it. And I don't want to out the organization, but the leader of that organization called me and said, Mike, there was no way in the world we were putting a quote fat rich white dude, you know, on the board. And people have asked me whether that upset me. And I said, I love the organization more because they were willing to do it. And they were willing to tell me, they were willing to say those words, right? Cool, amazing. And so my affinity for that organization has gone up because of taking that approach. We've got to get, everyone has bias. I don't care who you are. Everyone has bias. It's not about getting rid of bias. What it's about is getting people around the table, acknowledging, engaging the bias, and then working through decisions where they can get to an agreement when their biases collide. That's what it's about. And being okay with bias. You know, the utopia would be nobody has bias. That's never going to happen. But what we have to do is make sure that we're getting as many diverse perspectives around the table with as many biases as possible. So at the end of the day, the decision making we take, the decision making we make incorporates all of that into the end result instead of what historically has been a bunch of white dudes, privileged backgrounds, sitting around thinking they're smarter than everybody else. They're not. And, you know, if that's shocking to you, like, you're a dinosaur. You know, like, if saying that out loud is like, has any kind of like, you know, if that resonates with you in a negative way, anyway, it's like, man, you're a dinosaur.
Well, as we wrap up, you know, to put a positive spin on sitting around and thinking about stuff, I believe you're writing your third book, which I believe is going to be called Grace. How are you using Biggby's sabbatical policy to continue to explore this consciousness capitalism, this diversity of thought that you first encountered, as you mentioned, with Nathan around a campfire?
Well, you know, the sabbatical is something that we believe the biggest gift you can give somebody, the biggest gift you can give an employee is time. And so, you know, that's what the sabbatical is about, is take 3 months and go do whatever. And you get paid in full for those 3 months. And it's our gift to help you as an employee explore your passions, explore maybe a new way of living or a new way of doing things, you know. And so that's the sabbatical. We absolutely love it. And we found that it's a powerful force in the organization. When people have to rally around somebody going on sabbatical, people get to step up, take different kinds of opportunities, have different responsibilities. And then the person comes back from sabbatical and they've got a clean slate. And so they can enter the world and really take a good, long, hard look at what's the most powerful way for me to impact this organization. What should I be doing for the next year to have the most positive impact? And so the sabbatical has been a really powerful mechanism in our world for a long, long time.
So you wrote Grind, you wrote Grow, you're working on the third book now, which is really, as you mentioned, sort of embracing this conscious capitalism. Just sort of as a preview for our listeners who still need to go back and read the first two books, to be clear. Yeah. You know, how are you basically replacing profit with purpose? And does doing that limit either side of that equation?
Peter, that's the million-dollar question right there. And, you know, I'll sum it up with, so our purpose is to support you in building a life you love. If you interact with our business in any way, that our purpose is to support you in building a life that you love. Our vision is to improve workplace culture in America, to build better workplaces that are supportive, that are nurturing, that are loving. So I was on a podcast a month ago or so, and we get to the end of the conversation, and the host asked me, he said, you know, I appreciated his honesty. He said, Mike, do you really think that you can do this loving, supportive, nurturing stuff and build a billion-dollar brand? Because that is part of our vision, is building a billion-dollar brand. And I said, you've got that exactly wrong. I said, we are going to build a billion-dollar brand because we're building loving, supportive, and nurturing environments. Because you want to build a supportive, nurturing environment, the team will perform at a higher level than it ever would have. And the results from a traditional business metrics perspective will outperform. And there's case study after case study, books written about that, that when you live in this space of stakeholder capitalism and you're making the six stakeholders equal amongst each other, the business performs at a higher level financially, even though it's not only about the stakeholder. So, you know, that to me is the transition that we need to make. We need to be making these investments. We need to be doing these things. And we'll see that our organizations will become more powerful.
Well, one of the ways you read about becoming more powerful and changing your thought and going deeper is to read broad and deep. So final question, less combative than the one you just mentioned. You know, what are you reading right now? And what are the final thoughts you want to leave the audience with?
Well, what am I? I'm actually not reading at this moment because my book launches next week, and I have been, I've been probably 3 or 4 months into preparation for that, trying to record the audio version of the books, and so I've been, and then I'm also developing a keynote, right, to get out in the world and talk about all of this. So all my creative, all my time, everything I've got going is into those three things. But I think, you know, I read Willie Nelson's biography. I think that might have been the last book I read. Anyway, extraordinary. Like, if you want to talk about a story of somebody who, you know, stuck with it and went through all kinds of opposition and difficulty and so on to become the legend Willie Nelson, it's a great read. And, you know, that's one of my points in my book is, you know, we can't just read business books. There are so many lessons to be learned from somebody like, you know, like Willie Nelson, like Nelson Mandela, like these extraordinary people. And so, you know, I try to read more broadly. I don't really read fiction. I do stick to leadership management books and then a lot of biographies and sometimes I'll venture off into some other stuff. But right now my life is pretty much wrapped up with output, not input.
Well, we'll let you get back to that output and, you know, we'll see you in about a week and a half in New York for that book launch. Thanks so much, Mike, for joining us inside the Ice House.
Thanks, Peter. It's been great.
That's our conversation for this week. Our guest was Michael McFall, co-CEO of Biggby Coffee. His new book, Grow, Take Your Business from Chaos to Calm, from Greenleaf Publishing Group, is available now wherever you buy your books. If you like what you heard, please rate us on iTunes so other folks know where to find us. Got a question or comment you'd like one of our experts to tackle on a future show? Email us at icehouse@ice.com or tweet at us at icehousepodcast. Our show is produced by Josh King with production assistance and editing from Ian Wolf. I'm Pete Asher, your host, signing off from Michigan, home of Biggby Coffee and John Tuttle. Thanks so much for listening. Talk to you next week.
Information contained in this podcast was obtained in part from publicly available sources and not independently verified. Neither ICE nor its affiliates make any representations or warranties, express or implied, as to the accuracy or completeness of the information and do not sponsor, approve, or endorse any of the content herein, all of which is presented solely for informational and educational purposes. Nothing herein constitutes an offer to sell, a solicitation of an offer to buy any security, or a recommendation of any security or trading practice. Some portions of the preceding conversation may have been edited for the purpose of length or clarity.